This is Wild Lives with Susan Twite from Salida, Colorado. Long-billed curlews, shorebirds of short grass prairie. Driving home from Denver on a classic Rocky Mountain spring day, Richard and I left fog and sleet behind as we topped Kenosha Pass and dropped into South Park in bright sunshine. I had just put on my sunglasses when Richard pointed at a group of birds near the highway. Six shorebirds as big as grouse balanced on skinny blue-gray legs, probing the grass with outrageously long down-curved bills like surrealist darning needles. The mottled brown and tan plumage of their backs and their buff-colored bellies blended perfectly with the light and shadow patterns of the dry prairie. Long-billed curlews! I whipped around to keep them in view as we whizzed by. I considered asking Richard to turn around, but the birds were so close to the highway, I was afraid we'd spook them. Long-billed curlews are one of our rarest shorebirds. They're also North America's largest. That slender, curved bill measures 8 inches long, a third of their 2-foot total length. They stand a foot and a half tall, with wings that stretch 3 feet tip to tip. They are named for that improbable bill, and for the sound of their call, a drawn-out whistle that goes up at the end and which echoes over short grass prairies and sagebrush grasslands in summer. Curlew! Curlew! Long-billed curlews are called shorebirds. Indeed, these wading birds do winter along the southern Atlantic and Pacific coasts, picking ghost crabs and other invertebrates out of burrows in ocean beaches. But the shore where they spend their summers is metaphoric. They nest on the seas of grass and sagebrush that make up the western Great Plains from Texas to Alberta and the Great Basin from Nevada to British Columbia. In these wide-open landscapes, male long-billed curlews advertise both territories and availability by winging up and down in the air over their particular patch of treeless real estate, broadcasting that plaintive song. Females, which are slightly larger than the males with a different curve to their bill, presumably choose a mate by his song and the attractiveness of his territory. After the two mate, the pair scrapes a shallow depression in the soil, often near some prominence, a rock, shrub, or even a cow chip. Both parents incubate the 3 to 5 eggs the female lays in this sketchy nest, often stretching themselves full length on the ground to conceal their conspicuous silhouette from the sharp eyes of coyotes, bull snakes, and other predators. The eggs hatch in about a month and the precocious young run after their parents as the adults poke about in the prairie for insects, specifically grasshoppers, which they spear with those long, trash-picking beaks. The parents soon lead the downy young curlews to the shores of a nearby pond, lake, or slow-moving stream where the little ones can poke in the damp mud for aquatic invertebrates to eat. By late July, the young can fly and long-billed curlew families begin to make their way to distant southerly ocean shores for the winter. Their migration flocks once darkened the skies over the prairies by the hundreds of thousands. Market hunting in the late 1800s slashed their numbers, and breaking the sod for farm fields ate up their nesting habitat. Loss of habitat to agriculture, development, and cheatgrass-fueled fires continues to threaten curlew survival. Seeing the long-billed curlews alongside Highway 285 on our drive home the other day lifted my spirits, like seeing friends thought long lost since. Knowing that curlews still migrate through these landscapes, and that their plaintive calls still echo over at least some of the short grass and sagebrush seas, gives me hope for the future, theirs and ours, on this, the only animate planet we know. This is Wild Lives with Susan Twite. Thanks for listening.